And it's my great pleasure and honor to introduce Paul Slovic. Paul Slovic is a founder and the president of Decision Research and a professor of psychology at the University of Oregon. He received numerous awards. I won't list all of them, but they include Distinguished Scientific Contribution Award from the American Psychological Association, and honorary doctorates from Stockholm School of Economics and the University of East Anglia. He's an elected member of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences and the National Academy of Sciences. Paul is really a pillar of decision-making research. His important work on risk perception influenced how public policy is constructed, and of course, research in our own field. The pioneering work on preference reversals, and more generally later on construction of preference, had a tremendous impact on the field. The affect heuristic is another great concept that Paul introduced and showed how spontaneous emotions affect all kinds of decisions we make. All this work, of course, uncovers the deep sense in which our decisions deviate from rationality. I think Paul is a believer in the power of science, harnessing his scientific work to help address some of humanity's most severe problems. Or maybe not in the power of science, but at least in the duty of scientists to try. Okay, so his paper titled, "If I Look at the Mass, I Will Never Act. If I Look at One, I Will," that's a quote from Mother Teresa, is an outstanding example of such research. In his research on the topic, Paul showed that compassion for the victim diminishes when there are many of them. Even just for two victims, compassion is already lower than it is for a single one. And that, of course, explains different phenomena. I believe that Paul's relentless dedication to improving the human condition through rational analysis and outstanding scientific research will also be reflected in the talk we are about to hear. Thank you, Paul.
Thank you. I very much appreciate being here and the invitation, and I should say that my work has always been with other people. And I've been very much influenced by Ilana Tehila-Kogut. Their work has been very central to what I'll talk about today, as well as the work of Tversky and Kahneman, who I build on a lot. So I'm going to go sort of quickly. The slides will be available if anyone wants them afterwards. And advance the slides. Can I just put them up first? Yeah. Okay, good. I changed the title slightly. Doesn't matter. Okay, so where I'm going to go on this talk, I'm going to describe two behavioral studies that demonstrate two very powerful psychological biases, psychic numbing and security prominence, these behavioral studies don't allow mass killing. They demonstrate why we allow mass killings. Of civilians with little or no moral or ethical concerns. And I'll also describe some of the examples of these biases in the historical record, a failure to intervene in genocide and mass atrocities in one direction, and more recently in the atrocities, firebombing and nuclear bombing during World War II, and that issue. So the nuclear domain is also informs us about how people strategize about mass killing. And I'll conclude that the prevalence of these and other judgmental biases and the difficulty of avoiding them raises serious questions about the usefulness of the proportionality principle in many important conflict situations. After hearing the discussion yesterday, I think I have respect for the principle, but as a guiding principle, but The carrying it out, I think, is going to be the challenge and will be illustrated by what I talk about. Okay, good. So the problem, we are incoherent in our valuation of human life. We value individual lives greatly, but these lives lose their value when they become part of a larger crisis, and we do too little to protect them. Awareness of this problem and understanding its causes may possibly lead to overcoming it. That's the hopes. So let's start in the, from the, where I started in this work, was looking at genocide and mass atrocity. And we find that there's no taboo against mass killing of innocent lives in that domain. And the phrase, the more who die, the less we care, was put forth to illustrate what some of the, not only research implied, but what we saw, what we see in the world about us. So after the Holocaust, we heard the phrase, never again. We don't want this ever to happen again. But actually, it happens again and again. It's very common. Catastrophic episodes of killing via genocide and mass atrocities are all too common. They create an immense toll of suffering and death, often with little notice or resistance from the outside world. Samantha Power, a journalist in 2003, wrote this book, A Problem from Hell, America and the Age of Genocide, where she recounted over the course of the 20th century numerous occasions where the American government turned their back on genocides that were taking place in the world and failed to act. Excuse me. And it's a pretty shocking book. She won the Pulitzer Prize from it. She became famous. She went into the Obama administration, where everyone thought she would be the leader in getting the Obama administration to act against the genocides that were happening then, like in Darfur and in Syria. She tried and did not succeed very well, showing some of the problems that even someone who's committed as she was faced in the political realm, and sort of try to get at why that happened. But I thought this was pretty, I read this book, it was pretty shocking. And then I was invited to give a, participate in a seminar at Auschwitz. And I heard a scholar from the University of Maryland named Barbara Harf, who did a historical accounting of genocides and mass atrocities from 1950 to 2003. So the Genocide Convention was drafted in 1948, so that never again would that these things take place. The United Nations formed around then, and it was supposed to be dedicated to this. But we see from her, well, okay, I'm a little ahead of myself. Let me just finish with Power. What she said was, she says it takes political pressure to put genocide on the map in Washington. Genocide in distant lands has not captivated senators, congressional caucuses, lobbyists, or citizens. The battle to stop genocide has been repeatedly lost in the realm of domestic politics. And she then finished, she said, no U.S. president has ever made genocide prevention a priority, and no U.S. president has ever suffered politically for his indifference to its occurrence. It is thus no coincidence that genocide rages on. And it does rage on, and this is the slide from Barbara Harf. You can't read the details, but it's about 36 or so incidents of mass killings all over the world since 1950. So it is very common occurrence. So why is it that we rarely intervene in mass murder, genocide, and other human and environmental tragedies? There are many answers. Anything that's so powerful like this doesn't have a single cause. It has multiple causes. It's obviously difficult, dangerous, and costly to intervene in a sovereign country that's murdering its citizens, like what's happening in Sudan for the past 30 years. Issues of racism play a role. The fact that we respond less when things happen at a distance from us. There's an issue of responsibility. You know, why should our government be the ones to police the world? Shouldn't other countries join us? Things like that. But I focus on the three highlighted elements at the bottom of the page, which are psychological. One is that psychic numbing, the fact that information about these large-scale problems fails to convey affect and emotion, a false sense of inefficacy, which I'm not going to talk about today, and the third is the dominance of protecting national security over protecting foreign lives when decisions are made. We heard a lot about national security yesterday. I was interested to see that because I sort of came independently from what has obviously been is well known in the legal circumstances, but I sort of had to discover that on my own with some help from some Israeli psychologists who worked on this too. So these are the obstacles: numbing, this inefficacy, and then this biased decision-making phenomenon. So many of you, I'm sure, are familiar with the dual process theories of thinking, that we think and process information in two fundamental ways, and Danny Kahneman's book has highlighted this. It's been a brilliant, the bestseller, Thinking Fast and Slow, and we have the fast mode of thinking, which is intuitive and experiential and relates to stories and narratives and images and feelings. Feelings are prominent in this, and the feelings hit us very quickly when we look at some information comes to our attention. And the slow thinking is what we're taught to do in school, to be logical, reasoned, rational, to use arguments, to use mathematics. And there, that too is influenced by feelings, but the feelings come in at the end, in the back end. After we do the analysis, we see that this is something good or bad, that's worth doing or not. Whereas with the fast system, it happens almost instantaneously. And, there's a different system than I usually use. So, and what's important and stressed by Kahneman as well is that fast thinking is our default mode. We're almost, we can do slow thinking, but we rarely do it. Fast thinking is easy, it feels right, it usually works to get us through our day, but it has some problems. It is innumerate and thus can lead to serious mistakes, which I'll illustrate a bit. So we call it the arithmetic of compassion. It's a deadly arithmetic. It is not. It's a flawed arithmetic, and that's where this "more who die with less we care" notion comes from. So the feeling system is enumerate. It doesn't count really very well. Saving one life is hugely important to us. If you have two lives in danger, it doesn't feel twice as important. You're already feeling concerned about the one. You don't feel twice as concerned with two. And sometimes you feel less concerned. Following on work that Ilana and Tahila Kogut did, was showing that you start to lose feelings one versus eight, we found that it even is one versus two. Sometimes two is valued less than one. And since adding and multiplying are related, it's not a surprise that feelings don't multiply either. You can't multiply your feelings. And there's a number of people who have observed this and said interesting things about it. In the interest of time, I'll just show you one of these from Albert Szent-Györgyi, who was a Nobel Prize-winning biochemist. And later in his career, he became concerned about nuclear war. And he said, "I'm deeply moved if I see one man suffering, and I would risk my life for him. Then I talk impersonally about the possible pulverization of our big cities with 100 million dead. I am unable to multiply one man's suffering by 100 million. And he was right. You don't need to be an experimental psychologist to see this. People know this. And they know a lot of what we have substantiated with experiments is already known by people. The problem is we don't confront this knowledge. You know, we recognize it, but we don't deal with it. So here are some important questions related to this. How should we value the protection of human lives? This is very central to proportionality, I believe. And then the question, how do we value their protection? And the reason for asking the question twice is the answers differ. You know, and why do they differ, and why does this matter? So here are two normative, possible normative theories about how we should value human life as the number of lives increases. So the one on the left is a model that's based on the notion that every human life is intrinsically of equal value. So as the number of lives at stake increase, the value of protecting them just adds linearly. The model on the right, tweaks it a little bit. It says in some cases you may come to a threshold where you're on the brink of extinguishing a culture or a species. And the very next life then is even more important to protect than the one before it. So the curve tweaks upwards exponentially when the viability of a group or society is threatened. So these are possible normative models, but our actions in the face of catastrophic threats often don't seem to follow either of these normative models. And it's because if we're on the fast thinking, relying on feelings, our feelings override our analytic judgments. These first two models are analytic models, slow thinking models, but our feelings tend to be insensitive to large losses of life. So how do we value the saving of human lives, the protecting of lives? Here's two descriptive models. The one on the left is sometimes a psychophysical model. It's the model that's in the Kahneman-Tversky prospect theory. You see that it's nonlinear. It's sometimes called a psychophysical model because of the early German experimental psychologists who studied psychophysics found that the way our eye reacted to increases in magnitude of light energy followed this function. And the same thing with the way the ear responds to sound energy. In a quiet room, you can hear a whisper. It doesn't take much for you to notice the difference. If the room is larger, you need proportionally larger amount of change to notice the difference. That's what that figure on the left shows. But what prospect theory and these other theories missed is the fact that sometimes it's not always that it's just monotonically increasing and gets less and less sensitive, as the one on the left does. Sometimes it collapses or fades, and the numbers are so large, you just don't care at all. It's not that you're insensitive, but it's like it's not even real. So the singularity effect, this is very relevant to the psychophysical, the psychic numbing model, and I think Tehila's, Kogut and Alana's work has pointed to the importance of this. The notion of singularity. We place great value on saving individual lives. And you can see it then in this the same function. You see that the difference between 0 and 1 is the largest change in value. And you see that 2 is not twice as great as 1. And by the time you get up to 87, at some point it flattens out. Where it flattens out will depend on context. In this schematic diagram here, at 87 and 88, one likely doesn't feel any different when you're faced with a threat of 88 lives or 87. That life that's so important when it's the very first life that you're focused on loses its value when it's part of a larger phenomenon. That's what this shows. It loses its value. It's not consistent in value. Is that what we want? I collect articles from the paper that demonstrate this. You see it all the time. The man on the left, his truck went into the pond in the back. The guy on the right saw it happen. He went into the water and at some risk to his own life and pulled the man out of the truck. It doesn't have to be a human. Here's a group of people. They saw an elk fall into an icy lake in the mountains, and they went into the icy water and pulled the elk out. Famous story was the dog that was lost on a ship near Hawaii. The ship had engine trouble. They evacuated all the people, and then they sort of forgot about the ship. It drifted away, and they lost track of it. And then they realized there was this dog on the ship. It had a name, and it was an individual. They spent $300,000 to find the ship and rescue the dog. We do this all the time. Individual lives, human or animal, are highly valued. Opposite singularity is psychic numbing. Many instances, Rwanda is a very dramatic example. We just celebrated the 25th anniversary of the Rwandan genocide, where about 800,000 people were murdered in 100 days. The world knew about it and did nothing. The UN general who in charge of protecting keeping the peace there was asked. He was told it was going to happen. He asked for authority to intervene and stop it from the UN, and they denied him that. The Clinton administration denied him any support, and so he just stood by and had to watch this happen. So we've known this. People always, when I talk to them, many people know this quote. It's sometimes said to be Stalin, but it's debated. But the veracity of it, I think, comes through. One man's death is a tragedy. A million deaths is a statistic. Another one is that statistics are human beings with the tears dried off. So there's many laboratory experiments and surveys demonstrating numbing and collapse. I'm not going to go into detail. I'm just going to quickly illustrate a few. And we heard about some of this work yesterday from colleagues here, Statman and Renan and others that found an element of psychic numbing in the allowable number of deaths to achieve a military gain. And this was very interesting because it involved respondents who were lawyers and military people, not just students, and they found this. But this finding has been found a lot, in the literature. The first experimental study that I did was with a student of Amos Tversky's named David Featherstonhaugh. And this was shortly after the Rwandan genocide, 1994, where those who survived the genocide fled to refugee camps on the border between Rwanda and what was then Zaire, it's now Congo. And they suffered from lack of clean water, and they began to contract cholera. And there was this article in the newspaper, paying a lot of attention to what goes on in newspapers, from the pumps that saved Rwandans. So people were sending drilling equipment to drill and get fresh water to provide to the people in the camp. And so we created an experiment around this. We said, supposing you're an official in a neighboring country, you would like to help out in this situation. You have only enough money to provide pumping equipment and drilling and pumping equipment that could provide enough water to keep 4,500 people in the camp with clean water and therefore healthy. Would you do it? You have other uses for your money. You could spend it locally, domestically, on your schools, your roads, your hospitals, or would you send it to the refugee camp? People had a choice. And we had two groups of people. In both, we said, you could keep 4,500 people in clean water, but we varied the size of the camp. One group said the camp has 250,000 people, you can keep 4,500 people with clean water, would you do it? The other group, we said, the camp has 11,000 people, you could keep 4,500 people healthy. And which camp do you think people were more likely to donate to this? Probably have the intuition. Small camp. They were much more willing to send them, to choose to send the money over their domestic uses in the small camp, because people were responding proportionally, not to the number, but to the proportion of lives saved. That psychophysical function is a function that reflects proportional thinking, the actual number. To go from 250,000 people at risk to 245,500, it seems like you're on the flat part of that function. It doesn't seem to matter, but if you can cut it in half, that seems to matter. And this is very common, this proportional thinking. Another experiment we did was, we're interested in genocide, but obviously the first experiment had something to do with genocide because they were refugees from Rwanda. You can't really experiment very easily on genocide, obviously. But we used donation decisions to get sensitivity to numbers. And we gave people the opportunity to donate on behalf of a starving child on the right, her name was Rokia. She's 7 years old and from Mali, and she was facing starvation. And people could donate to save the children on behalf of children like Rokia. And some percentage of people donated some of their money to Rokia. And then we had another condition that we thought would increase the donations. We said, well, we want to emphasize to people, this is starvation in this area is a really serious problem. And so we put the statistics of starvation next to her picture that, you know, in her region there's millions of people starving. And we thought that would increase the donations. It had just the opposite effect. The donations dropped in half when people saw that she was part of this much larger problem. So you see, again, this proportional thinking. She's, or maybe even drop in the bucket kind of thinking, you know. And this also, I think, was evident in the studies that we heard about yesterday. So it's another example of the way the large numbers turn people off. Okay, this is not too readable, but this is a recent meta-analysis of March 2019 that talks about compassion fade. It's a, let me pull it up here. Title is Helping One or Helping Many, a Theoretical Integration or Meta-Analytic Review of the Compassion Fade Literature. So now, instead of just the numbing, we talk about the fading kind of thing. They found 41 studies and 95 independent samples with over 13,000 people that they analyzed to show a pretty consistent dropping off of feeling, not just insensitization, as numbers increase. So you see there's a lot of research going on in this, and it is finding this consistently. Here's an example of one of the studies by Friedrich and Dude that had a military context, but it was hypothetical. And they showed this thinking via the percentage saved rather than the number. Okay. That's study. Okay, so then this is a famous study by Kogut and Ritoff of multiple victims, and they had a scenario where there were 8 children being treated for cancer in the hospital, and they needed $300,000 American dollars for the treatment. People were asked if they would donate to that cause, and then they pulled individual photographs of individual children out of the picture and said, this one child needs $300,000, would you donate? And this was the result they found. Again, you see the diminishing, it's not just insensitivity, a diminishing with the 8, with the 1. And then some of us replicated that and found that you could get that with only 2 victims versus 1. So American writer named Annie Dillard was thinking about numbers, and she asked the question, at what number do other people blur for me? And one possible answer is that the blurring begins at the number 2. You can't focus your attention on 2 people simultaneously as carefully as you focus on 1, and you can't empathize as closely with 2 as with 1. You can still do it, but it starts to crack at 2. So no wonder it's gone at 200,000 or 2 million or 200 million. It's difficult unless you're doing the arithmetic with slow thinking. So that's the two people that need. So that's the story of numbing. That's the first part of this, showing the strange ways our feelings deceive us about the reality of large crises, threats. But I was once challenged in talking about numbing by someone who said that top decision makers, they're better informed. They know what's going on. They're not numbed. But they still decide not to intervene in these atrocities, even when the actual or potential loss of life is enormous. So something in addition to numbing is going on. And I started to think about that and worry about that. And then I was at a conference here in Jerusalem, and a young woman named Nurit Schnabel gave a paper from social psychology showing how we are more generous in helping others when we are secure in our own identities, that our own personal security allowed us to help others. And I started thinking about security and then looking at what was going on in the world, and I got an appreciation that it was security was going on. And I related this to another study, to work that I had actually started a long time ago, called the prominence effect, which is a decision-making problem. And the essence of this is that even slow, reasoned decision-making requiring trade-offs can be severely biased, for example, towards protecting national security, with little or no weight given to loss of human life. So in a sense, security trumps rights. And so what's going on here? And this is, show you in a minute where it originated from, this notion, is that we can express our preferences and our values in multiple ways. We can say what they are, or we could put numbers. We could say what is the acceptable number of something. So we can state our values that way, or we can express our values through our choice. The economists distinguish between stated or expressed values and revealed preferences and values, revealed through choice. And what you find in the psychological studies is that they're not the same. Even within the same person, a person can be inconsistent between what they say is important to them and what their actions then reveal is important to them. These are preference reversals. So when you state your values, the key thing, you don't usually have to justify why you believe, you know, that you believe something. But when you make a choice, there's a pressure for justification or for defensibility that is stronger than when you are just thinking abstractly about what you value. And that leads to a discrepancy in behavior, a disconnect between stated values and the values revealed by action. So I found this first, in, believe it or not, in 1961 in a consumer choice experiment, and found I was trying to get create a balancing indifference between two consumer objects, where A was better than B in one way, but B was so much better than A and the other, that they were equal in people. I find I couldn't create equality in these situations, that when people were asked to choose, they didn't flip a coin. They chose systematically. And when I saw how they chose systematically, I found they were choosing by what was intrinsically the more important dimension, even though they had presumably offset that in the balancing act. There was still the choice was the more important, and that was a hint that it's justification and defensibility that comes into play in choice that doesn't come in when you're thinking more abstractly about your values. So, difficult choices were resolved in favor of what was intrinsically the more important dimension justification. Amos Tversky got interested in this, and we redid this study in 1988. And we renamed the more important dimension effect the prominence effect, but it was basically the same kind of thing. So now coming back to genocides, for governments, national security in its various forms, whether it's economic, political, military, is the most prominent or defensible value in today's world. Strongly held humanitarian values, which we state as important, tend to decline or even collapse when they're pitted in decision-making against security objectives. And this is a non-compensatory thing. You think about, we talk about balancing and trading off, but this is basically a non-compensatory process. So when humanitarian life-saving and national security seem to conflict, we do not intervene, no matter how many thousands or millions of lives hang in the balance. And some recent examples are the atrocities in various parts of Sudan, Syria, Yemen, Myanmar taking place. It's obvious. So again, think of that. We heard a lot yesterday about balancing. You've got a scale. You're balancing a bundle of national security objectives versus protection of foreign lives. And prominence prominence can be thought of as an attentional spotlight. So we know attention drives everything. Things have to come to the attention of your senses and your brain for you to feel a concern and to act. And attention is a scarce resource. And in this case, what seems to be happening is that while we know and we say that protecting human life is important, we start to think about the problem, our attention focuses on our national security objectives. And it's not that we are consciously devaluing human life, but the end result is that these lives get devalued through this attentional spotlight. It's like, you may have seen this famous experiment about the inattentional blindness. Prominence is like this. So the experiment, there's a bunch of people. You see a video of a bunch of people passing a basketball around to each other, and you're asked to count the number of passes that you see taking place. So people are counting passes. And while they're doing that, a man in a gorilla suit walks across the front of the stage. And then they're asked later, did you see the guy in the gorilla suit? And sometimes almost half the people never saw this person. They were so focused on the basket, the passing, that they didn't see it. Well, it's the same thing. You get so focused on the national security thing that you lose track of the human toll that your decisions might be making. So one of the things that the proportionality principle might do is, if it calls attention and doesn't let you forget about the human side, that could be an important contribution, because otherwise you'll devalue it. So here's some examples of this in the humanitarian side, this prominence. George Bush said, the most important job I've had, and the most important job the next president's going to have, is to protect the American people from another 9/11 attack. And he was right, because Obama said the same thing. I have a solemn responsibility to keep the American people safe. That's my most important obligation as president and commander-in-chief. But so that's the security importance. But Obama acknowledged the importance of humanitarian life-saving, as in Syria. He said he acknowledged very real and legitimate humanitarian interests in Syria. At the time of this talk, 80,000 people had been killed. It kept going to hundreds of thousands. And he said millions have lost their homes. Obama recently, he said, acknowledging that, he said, but his bottom line has to be, what's in the best interest of America's security? And he did not intervene in Syria to try to protect the Syrian people. Okay, so that's the story on genocide. And more recently, I was asked to start thinking about some issues regarding to the risk of nuclear war, particularly in today's world of modern social media, where, you know, Donald Trump and Kim Jong-un can bypass all diplomatic channels and hurl insults at each other through Twitter and so forth. But I started to think about that, and I look into the history of nuclear weapons use and decision making, and I saw that things are even worse in that domain than in the humanitarian. As bad as they are with the genocide stuff, it's even worse in warfare. So the genocide stuff, it's psychological mechanisms that lead to inaction in the face of genocide and other humanitarian crises. What you see in the domain of warfare is that numbing and security prominence explain not inaction, but action intended to kill vast numbers of human beings with nuclear weapons. So this is now commission of killing. So whereas psychic numbing and compassion collapse inadvertently lead to deficient feelings regarding large losses of life because of our cognitive and emotional limitations, these numbing and compassion lead to actions, and they're combined with some other things that demolish feelings as well, which is tribalism, us versus them, dehumanization of victims, and blaming of victims, which combined with numbing and prominence allow mass killing to be perpetrated without challenge from normal feelings and moral conscience. So this is quite an array of phenomena, psychological phenomena here. Where did I? Okay. I think I lost my track here. I pushed the wrong button.
The left button.
Oops, sorry. I think, oh my goodness. Sorry about this. Okay, that's where I was. Okay, so dehumanization, you're familiar with that. That was a key element that led in the Nazi campaign to convert normal good citizens into murderers. And we saw this in the U.S. In the hatred towards Japanese people, where we interned Japanese citizens into camps, and we dehumanized them by equating them with vermin and insects. This is a typical propaganda poster showing a caricature of a Japanese soldier and a malaria and mosquito. They're both enemies, and it's your job to eliminate them. This is kind of a dehumanization sorts of things. And so mass psychic numbing and compassion deficits are not just figments of laboratory experiments, but they occur frequently in animal trials and warfare. And it shows that there's no taboo against mass killing in support of prominent military and security values. So even before we had nuclear weapons, our commanders in World War II did not refrain from using firebombs to attack cities and civilians with destructiveness comparable to or even greater to that which occurred in Hiroshima and Nagasaki. So General Curtis LeMay was the architect of all this killing. He led a firebombing campaign against more than 60 Japanese cities, killing hundreds of thousands of people, including 100,000 or so in Tokyo in one night. And he was told he attacked every large city in Japan till he ran out of planes and gasoline and firebombing gasoline. And he was told you can only spare, you have to spare three cities. One was Kyoto because it's a sacred city. The other two were Hiroshima and Nagasaki because we had other plans for them. We did not want to drop an A-bomb on a city that already had been destroyed by firebombing. And so we went ahead and on that. And then after the war, so LeMay was responsible for killing in all this campaign between, he led the killing of 500,000 to 1 million people, probably. He said, killing Japanese didn't bother me very much. It was getting the war over that bothered me. So I wasn't worried particularly about how many people we killed. So we wanted to protect our own military. We had lost a lot of people. We wanted to stop the slaughter of our troops. And so we dropped all this weaponry on Japanese civilians to end the war sooner. Daniel Ellsberg, very famous from the Pentagon Papers expose that was important both in leading to the downfall of Richard Nixon and ending our involvement in Vietnam. Also, and he was also an early member of our judgment and decision-making field. He got his PhD at Harvard in decision-making operations research and did the famous Ellsberg paradox in that study. But then he went on and became a security analyst at the RAND Corporation, and that's where he went to Vietnam. And then later he was in the inside the room in discussions with the nuclear war planners around 1960. And he wrote this book, which just came out in 2017, about nuclear war. And he reports many examples of numbness, psychic numbing, among the war planners, numbness to consequences. So, for example, he noticed, he received plans that showed after the war, we targeted, the Soviet Union became the enemy after World War II. And we were worried about Stalin and that Stalin wanted to take over the world and dominate that. And we had a slight lead on Stalin with atomic bombs. Anyway, we laid out plans. The U.S. Aimed its growing missiles supply at cities in mostly Russia and China. And in 1955, there were 15 million people in the line of the targeting of our nuclear weapons. And then he saw the result. He saw the same plans then in 1961. Suddenly, it was 200 million, 15 million to 200 million. What was the strategic, thing that led to that increase? Well, it was simply that we substituted H bombs for A bombs. It was just a technological change. It wasn't a rationale about the necessity, benefit, the trade-offs. Now we had bigger bombs, so we aimed them, and that was, 200 million people were in the line of sight. He says that this change was introduced not because it was judged to be necessary, because it was just simply what the new, more efficient nuclear bombs, vastly larger in yield, could and would accomplish when launched against the same targets. And he said the risk that the presidents and the Joint Chiefs of Staff were consciously accepting involved the possible ending of organized society, the very existence of cities in the Northern Hemisphere, along with the deaths of nearly all its human inhabitants. Later, he got more documents, because he was privy to these top secret documents, that showed that our war planners had aimed our missiles at more than 600 million people in the Soviet Union and China. And he stated in his book, he says, the fatalities that the Joint Chiefs of Staff were reporting to the White House were the estimated results of the U.S. first strike. The total death count was in the neighborhood of 600 million dead, almost entirely civilians, 100 Holocausts. He said, I remember my feelings holding this paper with its numbers in my estimated in my hand, looking at it in an office at the White House annex, 1961. I remember thinking, this piece of paper should not exist. It should never in the course of human history have come into existence. It depicted evil beyond any human project that had ever existed. There should be nothing on earth, nothing real, that it referred to. And I think it shows the insensitivity to the numbers of, you have this technology which can create consequences that we really can't comprehend. And the incoherence between the singular importance of individual lives and the importance of protecting mass and the acceptability of mass killing was brought home in 1961 by a proposal by a Harvard-trained lawyer, Roger Fisher, that the secret code that the American president needs to initiate a nuclear attack be implanted near the heart of a person whose life would have to be sacrificed to begin the process of killing millions. People reacted with horror at the thought of doing something so inhumane as to killing a person to get these codes to kill millions. It shows our minds can't really grapple with this. Okay, I'll finish up now in a couple of minutes. So what about the American public? Well, don't count on the American public either to put a brake on the president. There was a study, a 2015 survey by Scott Sagan and a colleague, and it was replicated just a few weeks ago by Daniel Vestal and myself, about a hypothetical war scenario with Iran, which things are heating up with Iran right now. Pardon?
Doesn't seem so hypothetical right now.
Yeah. And the question is said, well, there's a land war. We're fighting a land war with Iran. It's estimated we could lose 20,000 American troops. Would you individually prefer that we continue the land war or drop a nuclear bomb that could kill either, in one case, 100,000 Iranian citizens or 2 million? There was two scenarios there. What's your view? And a surprising high percentage of American participants approved of using nuclear weapons against the civilian population of Iran, killing up to 2 million if they believed it would protect 20,000 soldiers. And it was scope insensitive. It was little difference in response between 100,000 or 2 million. You got exactly the same results. In the interest of time, I'm going to skip over the data and conclude and leave time for discussion. So in face of psychic numbing and simplified non-compensatory decision-making strategies that severely devalue human lives during armed conflict, is the proportionality principle anything more than wishful thinking? Can education about these biases, coupled with decision-aiding techniques, keep humanitarian values from collapsing when security is threatened? So maybe those are an opening questions for discussion. Thank you very much.
For a wonderful lecture, Professor Slovic. I have 2 points. One, you didn't mention the other or otherness in the first part of your talk until you came to the nuclear issue. Isn't it a part of what we see in the numbing processes? And the second question is, I wonder whether there is no tension between atrocities and national security in the sense that national security people can claim that what they are expressing is a very high sensitivity to human life because they translate national security to millions of human lives, very many human lives, and then taking care about so many lives can bring the opposite result of a high readiness to infringe upon human rights, including torture, including killings, for the sake of the many, many lives. So the issue of many, many lives can act in different interesting ways.
Yes, oh, thank you. So certainly the us versus them, the otherness, is very central to the humanitarian, to turning our backs. We turn our back on the others and not as likely on ourselves. But we find that while that's important, it's not the determining factor because we see this insensitivity to number in our own backyards, in our own cities and towns where there are social problems that, you know, in the U.S. we have problems of poverty, homelessness, that are statistical right in our own cities and states that we tend to underreact to. So even though these are people, but maybe we draw distinctions between us and, we're very good, humans are very good at distinguishing them, their group from some other group, even. So yes, the answer is yes, it's very relevant. The other issue about security, well, isn't security really about protecting lives? It can be, it can be. But in other cases, you see that, like what was going on in Darfur, Omar al-Bashir came into power in Sudan. He just was ousted after 30 years, 1989, and he spent 30 years murdering the black African population of Sudan, the non-Arab population, and in particular, there were when people started to rebel in Darfur, Western Sudan, in 2003, he started to mass annihilation of that population, and we knew about it. Nothing was done about it because we were getting security information from the government because it had been an Al Qaeda training ground, and the government was giving us little bits and pieces about possible terrorist history there, and that was more valuable to us than trying to get him to stop murdering innocent people who were just unhappy with his government. Now, I don't think there was any threat. We're protecting against terrorists. So maybe there was we thought the terrorism was a security, although terrorism has killed very few people. Yes, a little bit we're protecting that, but I don't think it can explain the tremendous acceptance of immoral massacre of innocent people that we see.
We have a few more questions. Should we collect all the questions, take all the questions, and then Paul can answer? So,
thank you. So two things. First, there's also this issue of identifiable and non-identifiable lives. So in your example about the one person whom you will implant, you know, the number in, that's an identifiable person who would surely die when you, you know, when you have to kill all those unnamed millions. So I think that's a very, so you could think about, you know, the difference between, we know that there are 400, in Israel at least, there are 400 people each year dying of car accidents, but we don't know who they are. The government doesn't do almost anything to stop that. If we were to name them in advance, I'm sure that the idea of doing something to stop that would be, everybody would be much more inclined to take serious measures to stop the killing of those 400 people. And just a conceptual regarding the prominence effect and balancing versus necessity, which was discussed yesterday, I understood, although I'm sorry I wasn't here. I think the prominence effect is very relevant to that because in proportionality, balancing to us seems much more prominent than necessity. So I think this is a reason why even after people take necessity into account, they think they still should do the balancing. And this is, I think this is one of the reasons why proportionality is, for example, much less protective of rights than probability. So, thank you.
So next question.
I had basically the same question as Gila Stopler about the identification of the people that that we are trying to save. Well, that makes a difference, and what the, how this effect relates to this psychic numbing effect. And the only experiment that I've seen was this, where you had $300,000 to save one life versus eight. There it seems that identification wasn't really a variable that could have played a role. But with all the other examples, one could have thought as well about identification of the person as being the main driving factor. Maybe you could also elaborate a bit more on that.
Mm-hmm. Next question.
So two unrelated questions. The first, why wouldn't you think that maybe a legal framework which puts proportionality at its heart, and notwithstanding the fact that abstractly proportionality may not generate clear determinate limits, but forcing us to think through a various set of scenarios and then relating our intuitions to one another. So why isn't this kind of a procedure which requires us to kind of think slow, because it's a legal requirement, because it'll be a war crime if we don't, and we do something that violates it. So why shouldn't we expect this, first of all, a legal framework to provide kind of a way to force planners to think slow and to create certain kind of internal coherence between different types of situations, and thereby having overcoming the type of biases, maybe that's the hope that might otherwise exist. So at least one might imagine institutional contexts which are organized in a way where proportionality might then have that effect, even though it probably will depend on the institutional context. So that's the first question. But the second is, and I'm not sure it's a fair question, but one of the things, neither the prominence effect you describe nor the numbing effect, both of which I find intuitively plausible, describe the most remarkable phenomenon, I think, of certainly the last 20 years in terms of people interested that I thought would trigger the interest of behavioral psychologists, and that is the massively disproportionate response to terrorism, to terrorist threats, as a matter of public policy. Now, Israel is not a good place to discuss this because it's an ongoing real threat, but of course in the Western world, generally in the United States, even in the UK, Paris, Germany, it's an absolutely peripheral phenomenon. It happens very occasionally, but in terms of overall threat, it's just so negligible compared to so many other things that there seems to be a deep irrationality in the responses to it. So how would you make sense of that, if I may ask?
maybe I could take these four before. We can go on. All good questions. So a couple of people talked about identifiability. I should let Ilana answer that because she has done some of the important research on identified versus non-identified victims. It does make a difference. We still respond to even non-identified victims more in the small than the large, but that's certainly a factor. What would you have any further comments?
Identifiability actually affects response to a single victim,
yeah.
And it turned out it doesn't do much if you have more than one. Even if you show the pictures and whatever.
As kind of the in-group, out-group, and Alana and others have studied, whether the victim is in our in-group or out-group, it also these things make a difference. The comment on the balancing, I wasn't quite sure I understood your point about the balancing issue. Maybe you could restate that question.
So, yesterday there was a discussion on if you have, in the proportionality analysis, you have the balancing and then you have the necessity. You actually do the necessity first, and then the balancing should only be between the rights and the and the government objective after the necessity has already been measured. And the question is why does balancing at this stage make the necessity weaker, even though it shouldn't have?
Yeah.
And just what I was thinking was it's because of the prominence effect, because we have this in our minds. Proportionality is first and foremost balancing. So what we have to do, we have to balance. We have to say this is on the one hand, this is on the other, and then let's balance it. Even though it's necessary, we'll balance it again.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. And what we find is that the concept of balancing is very difficult for people to really balance, unless you sort of force people to consider in slow thinking. And this relates to Matthias's important point about wouldn't proportionality lead to better decision making by making us think slowly and keep things in the center of attention. And I think that possibly that could be the case. I think that's the hope. And in fact, there's research going on that tries to get people, when there's multiple objectives to consider, to rather than responding quickly, our tendency is to respond instantly because we can often get a fast reaction. But to slow down, even list what is important about each alternative and the objectives. What are the objectives at stake? How important are they? Just to think carefully, to keep those in mind and then make your decision. And we find that can affect the decision making. And so certainly the concept of proportionality has a respect for life that hopefully will boost its prominence and keep it from being ignored the way it actually is ignored. I would say that is a definite possible thing that could happen because otherwise inadvertently we devalue these lives. This it fights against that. And other thing suggestions that have been made is that around the table you could have a decision analyst that leads you to exercises. They know how to help you structure the problem. What are your options? Are you sure there's no other options to consider? Tries to force creative option development. Now, what are the objectives that you have, and how does each option match with your goals and objectives? And what are the possible trade-offs to make? You can do that, but that's hard work. We don't always have those analyses analysts around. So another option is to have always, because we know that there's a bias leading to devaluation of large numbers of lives. Have an advocate for those lives at the table who won't let you forget to include those in your balancing or decision thinking. And that's, I think, a more feasible kind of thing. Sometimes I don't, politically it could be problematic, but it, and, but then also the more general acknowledgement of and understanding and respect for a proportionality principle would essentially kind of might do the same thing through inculcating the importance of keeping in mind the collateral damage and not letting that fall off the table because it falls off the table otherwise. So I'm in agreement with you that that's something that could be very important and result of the proportionality principle. Your last question is very important about the terrorism, and that's I think a dramatic illustration of another aspect. The psychic numbing is a fault with our feeling system, and the fact that the feeling system can't add. Well, the feeling system also can't multiply with probability. So the thing about a terrorist act, it's very dreadful, and when you think about the possibility of terrorist acts, you get this strong negative feeling, anxiety, worry, fear, and what happens then is that even though much of this these are low probability events, the feeling system cannot multiply and calibrate that feeling by a probability. There's no way that our brains can multiply a feeling by a probability. That's part just where this is where you can't add feelings. You can't multiply feelings by probabilities. So and there's experiments that show that people respond just as strongly to a 1% chance of a negative event like as to a 99%, because and it's called probability neglect. And it's again a flaw in our feeling system when you don't think analytically, you don't take into account, you know, how rare it is. We can do the math. If you do it with analytic thinking, you can see these, you know, you really shouldn't have to take your shoes off just because one person did it once and billions of people take it. You know, so it's again, it's a problem of the affective system that leads us to feel threatened even when the likelihood is very, very low. And it's also an issue of defensibility too, that the people in charge want to make sure that, you know, they don't want to have these things happen. So, and they know people are worried about all this stuff, so we have to do all kinds of things that we react really strongly to rare, terrorism is nothing to take lightly, but and it's more serious in some places than others, but there's a tendency to overreact to that. It's again a feeling thing, but a little bit different from the others.
Apologies, we're going to cut off this fascinating debate, and I'm inviting people on your behalf to come up with their questions during lunch and in the following coffee breaks. You won't have much of a break. We'll continue the queue there, and we're going to take a very, very short break just to allow the PowerPoint. So borrowing from yesterday's dinner, you'll listen to the gong, and the gong will bring you back, not to the ceremony of the makluba, but to the ceremony of the next panel. So, 2 minute break.